Good morning again, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Assembly Section 1 of the AAPA 57 Assembly of Presidents. Without further ado, may we now invite Mr. Andrew Herdman, Director General of the AAPA, to come on stage and give us his presentation. Mr. Herdman, please.
Well, thanks for coming back, and I'm going to make a presentation that talks about Asia-Pacific aviation, but from a global perspective. We are a big part of the world, and it helps to understand the world if you understand Asia, and it helps to understand Asia better if you understand the global context. And I'll talk not just about regulatory issues in some depth, but try and give you a flavor of my view of the where we are commercially in terms of the state of the industry. Aviation is part of everyday modern life. Global mobility, 3 billion passengers out of a global population of 7 billion is an astonishing figure. And the other way of looking at it is 8 million passengers a day. So when regulators are thinking about what to do with this industry, remember, you're affecting 8 million people a day. Every time you change a procedure, a process, a requirement, we're talking about mass transit. Dispel any idea of luxury travel for the few. This is mass transit. Air cargo is probably about 1% of the tonnage, but it's 35% by value. So cargo for us is a $60 billion industry globally, but it carries $6 trillion worth of goods, 35% the value of global trade. So aviation brings employment, 57 million jobs depend directly or indirectly upon air transport, and this delivers social and economic benefits to the wider community. And we're committed to sustainable growth. Now, it's been a busy year. These are just a montage of a few snapshots. Lots of new aircraft in the air. If you're spotting aircraft, we used to look at the tailpipe of the APUs. Now we look at the wingtips very closely to try and guess which aircraft is which. Rebrandings, people joining alliances, people launching new products, first-class products, business-class products, premium economy products, and even upgrading economy seats with more modern in-flight entertainment. The 100th A380 is up in the air. Lion Air, a single airline that was probably unheard of 10 years ago, just took delivery of their 100th 737. So exciting times, new joint ventures. When I showed a similar montage a year ago, I took the precaution of saying not all these ventures will succeed. Not all of them do. You put them in the marketplace, you experiment, it's the market that decides which are the winning business models, which are the winning companies, which are the people who best execute. It's not about nominating a business model and going to collect your winnings. And regardless of your business model, you have to execute well in order to win in this very competitive game. So just give you a heads up on the sort of topics I'm going to talk about, an overview of Asia-Pacific aviation, a few comments about the state of the industry and competitive issues, and then quite an extended session on regulatory issues that are the bread and butter of trade associations like AAPA, and then a wrap-up. If we take all the airlines based within the region together, aggregate them, this is a snapshot of Asia-Pacific aviation. Overall, Asian Airlines carries, you can see at the bottom, about 30% of global passenger traffic and almost 40% of global cargo traffic. These are two very important numbers. In comparison, the Americans and Europeans carry about 20% of cargo each. In passenger terms, they're comparable to, although I think Asia's now ahead. It used to be three roughly equal shares of the global passenger business. Now, how's the global economy doing? The light blue is the emerging and developing economies. The dark blue is the traditional advanced economies, developed world. And the dotted line is the average of that. So the key feature from this graph is, as of about 10, 15 years ago, when everything was in lockstep, the developing economies got moving. And since then, we've been in a two-speed global economy. Developing economies grow at about 6 average. The developed economies have moved along at about 2%, and then the average of that is about 3 to 4% global growth. But although it's a two-speed global economy, there's only one global economy. And the success of the developing economies is built on consumer demand in the developed advanced economies. So these differential growth rates are changing the shape of the global economy, but they're also creating financial imbalances that had something to do with the financial crisis that hit the industry, hit the world 5 years ago. Christine Lagarde of the IMF a few months ago said, well, we talked about a two-speed economy, now we're in a three-speed economy. The US grows at 2, the developing world grows at 6, and Europe's stuck at 0. But if someone says to you, you're doing your budget for next year and I'll give you 3% global growth, I always say, take it. Less than 3% is a tough world. If someone offers you 3% and the IMF said it's 3.4 or 3.3 or whatever it is, but take it. 3% global growth is just fine. We should be grateful. But it has been tough in the last couple of years. The forecasts are to pick up slightly in 2014. Let's hope they're right. Now, if you want one slide to put in your wallet and remind or explain to anyone, explain the business, this slide just about does it. The red line is passenger business, the blue line is cargo business. The scales are different, but the patterns are what's important. So in the passenger business, it dipped a bit in the recession, and it then just grew and grew and grew. It's amazing. All the uncertainty, all the headlines, collapse of the Eurozone, end of the world, oil crisis, war, the passenger business grows, roughly 5%. What happened in the cargo business? We had a fantastic 2008. The world came to an end in 2009. 2010 was a colossal rebound. And since then, it's done nothing. The right-hand side of the blue line is barely above where we were in 2008. So the challenge is that the cargo business volumes are where they were 6 years ago. Nobody forecast that. So the world is full of surplus cargo capacity for two reasons. We had a lot of freighters and we kept buying them and taking delivery. And the other thing is the red line. Every time you put an aircraft into the serve the passenger market, you get a lot of belly capacity, particularly wide body. So that red line has grown 25% the last 5 years. That means belly cargo capacity has grown 25% the last 5 years, but the cargo demand hasn't done anything. So if you're in the freighter business, you get the leftovers after the belly has absorbed what it can, and freighters therefore are surplus to requirements. If you do the maths, 25% growth in the passenger business and zero growth in cargo means you've got to take out somewhere around 15% of the freighter capacity. So that's being done with or without fanfare. It's destroying old values of old freighters. It's accelerating retirements. New freighters are still being put into the fleet because at high fuel prices it makes sense. So it's a tale of two businesses. The cargo is important to Asian Airlines. We're the leaders. It's a big part of our business. And when the cargo business is suffering, most of you are suffering as a result of that. It's a drag on results. What about the passenger business? Premium and economy, just to simplify into two market segments, which is an oversimplification. The economy business dipped and then grew. The premium business was much more badly affected by the downturn. And it's taken a long time to get global premium traffic back to where it was pre-recession. The picture in Asia is a little bit more optimistic. We got back to where we were before a bit earlier. But business travel in the developed world has been much slower to recover. And in some markets like Europe, there's a secular shift away from regional business travel to its just economy. Now, in Asia, we have a lot of competition. 7 of the world's top 10 busiest routes are here. Most of the traffic is on very busy routes. We talk about opening up new destinations, but the reality is that we have a lot of traffic, 85% of traffic on routes of 100,000 passengers a year. And we have a lot of competition. It's very common to see 3 airlines, 4, 5 airlines competing on the same route. You don't see that in Europe. You don't see that in America. It's not just because we have a lot of airlines. It's the nature of competition. People talk about what's going to happen when Asia liberalizes. it already has. This is what you get. So this makes it very tough, because strategy is about guessing what your competitors are going to do. If you've got one competitor in a route, it's one thing to guess what he's going to do next on pricing or capacity. When you've got this sort of situation, it's very dynamic. Entering markets, leaving markets, adjusting capacity has to be much more nimble, a point I mentioned this morning. So this partly accounts for the dynamic business model and service innovation that we see you and others pursuing. No matter which business model you're in, you have to fill up the tanks, and fuel is expensive. I used to talk about volatile oil prices. It's not volatile, it's just high. $123 a barrel. Fuel's about 35% of the cost of flying. The more efficient you are, the bigger that percentage. For some of you, it's 40% of the cost of flying. For some people, it's 50% of the cost of flying is fuel. At $123 a barrel, that's about a $200 billion fuel bill. So $200 billion from us to the oil companies. Believe me, the oil companies make more profit on the $200 billion than we ever make on the $700 billion that we earn as an industry. I'll come on to that. This is the trail of profitability. Lots of red, but we are in a period where the industry is profitable, but barely so. The left-hand side is billions, as are the numbers. So the industry made about 19 billion in 2010, when we had an unexpected rebound. Then profits were squeezed and squeezed again. In those periods, Asian Airlines accounted for about half those profits. IATA are now forecasting a pickup this year to about $12 billion and $16 billion next year. But look at the right-hand side. The right-hand side is the net margin. $16 billion, even if we achieve it as an industry, is less than a 3% margin. Another way of looking at it is divide the billion-dollar profit number by the number of passengers. As Tony Tyler said, last year the profit margin was a cup of coffee per passenger. This year it's a sandwich. Things are looking up. And despite these thin margins, boy, do we handle a lot of cash. $700 billion flows through the industry. Not much of it sticks for shareholders at the bottom line. But because we're fantastic at handling cash, we're targeted by governments as a cash cow. And the idea is they won't notice it. Of course, the airlines don't pay it, it's the passengers who pay it. And the damage isn't airline CEOs complaining, the damage is it deters people from traveling. It damages the wider travel and tourism sector. It deters people from creating new jobs. It's not a sensible thing to do. Some people understand that and don't tax aviation. They see that it's a positive catalyst. But in too many countries, aviation is seen as a tax cash cow. Now, just to go back to the profitability, if we unpack the global profitability and by region, historically, Asian Airlines made about half the profit pool. We're about 30% of the business, but we made about half the profit pool. But our profits are stagnating, as you can see. Who's looking good? The Americans. The Americans have been increasing their profitability. They're in a market with very limited growth, particularly domestic. They're very disciplined about, they don't misjudge what capacity to put into the market in terms of guessing the growth rate. They know the growth rate's going to be very modest. They have very disciplined capacity management. They've maximized load factors, record in the world. And as a result, the bottom line is improving quite significantly. So for the first time, as long as I can remember, the US carriers will be the leaders in terms of profit performance within the industry. Even Europe, which has been having a very tough time, you can see the results coming through from the majors, the more successful leading LCCs, and so on. And the Middle East, again, an upturn. So the big challenge for the Asian airlines is, why aren't we benefiting from the same upturn? And I think it comes back to what I've said about cargo and competition. No matter which business model you're in, competition is keeping yields very tight. So it's It's never easy to make a buck in this business. No matter how good you are, you still face these competitive pressures. That profitability and the expectations of the next 20 years are what gets translated to what I call enterprise values. Enterprise value is the blue bit, which is market capitalization, equity, and the red bit, which is long-term debt. So Delta, you want to buy Delta lock, stock, and barrel, it's $25 billion. You couldn't buy much of Apple for that, but that's what an airline, a big airline, is worth. United, almost up there. This is an updated chart. The improving profitability in America has led to rising valuations for US carriers. But in our part of the world, even without the consolidation that has really concentrated the US industry, we have some very valuable carriers. Here are some examples. Also note the difference in debt equity ratios. You have carriers that have very little debt, Singapore Airlines, very cash rich, Japan Airlines, New Japan Airlines, post restructuring. But others have heavy burdens of debt. So the question is, overall, you may take your own view as to which is the right balance. But the key point to make is that even though we haven't had consolidation in Asia, the major Asian players are valued at levels comparable to the most successful carriers in other regions of the world. So don't lose heart. The stock market thinks you can do it. You just have to deliver. Now let me turn to the regulatory challenges, or some of the many, on these topics, and I'll run through them very quickly. But first, I said this morning, who makes the rules? We know who wins the commercial battle. It's a good competition. But if you ask who makes the rules, there are two places to look to. One is Washington, the other is Brussels. I don't have a figure, but is it 80% of rules come out of these places, or 90%? I don't know. The rules come out of these countries. We're bound by them. If you fly to America or Europe, even if you don't fly to America or Europe, you're bound by the same rules, because these rules cascade out. They're copied, modified, applied by regulators around the world. Some follow the US, some follow the EU. ICAO tries to impose global standards, but don't underestimate the power of these political, unified political structures in Washington and Brussels. And so the association on your behalf spends a lot of time cultivating relationships with people in these capitals, who are the decision makers, the policy makers, in terms of shaping policy, as well as at ICAO at a global level. In Asia, of course, we have diversity, of which we're proud. A lot of people, we used to be 25% of global GDP, we're now up to 37% of global GDP. Income levels are rising, driving more travel. Political diversity is the challenge when it comes to collaboration and cooperation, particularly in trying to get an Asian perspective and an Asian voice into the global policy agenda. And we don't have a common regional regulator. Other regions of the world do. We don't have unifying political structures, although APEC, ASEAN, such institutions perform a valuable role. But you know, Asia's diversity reflects its history, and it's something to be proud of. We just have to work together on a multilateral basis in order to be successful together. Now, on safety's been improving steadily for decades, and Asia-Pacific safety is in line with world standards. Flying is extraordinarily safe. It's so safe you can talk about it. In my early days in the industry, you were careful not to talk about safety because it had bad connotations. It was thought you couldn't talk positively about it. But now you can talk about how extraordinarily safe it is to fly. If we look at the trend over the last 10 years, just the last 10 years, the industry used to have one major accident in a million flights. About 5 years ago, the industry got to about one accident in 2 million flights, and now it's pushing towards one in 3 million flights. So remember, when we're talking about safety, we're not managing accidents. there are very, very few. So far this year, there have been 5 major Western-built commercial jets lost, and 33 fatalities. So the problem of safety is, you gave me 1 million safe flights, give me 2 million safe flights. Give me 3 million safe flights. Give me 4 million safe flights. So the miraculous success of aviation in terms of managing safety is to be able to scale up into millions of safe flights. But every accident is one too many, and obviously there's no room for complacency. If you look at the Asia Pacific trend, it's fallen even more steeply than the global trend. In the last few years, it seems to be plateauing. But this partly a statistical effect. There are about 7 million flights run by Asian Airlines, 6 million flights run by Asian Airlines. So you can only, to meet these sort of performance levels, 2 accidents is probably too many per year. So a good year is no accidents. And in a year with no accidents, 1 accident or 2 accidents, these are statistical fluctuations, because this is the level of safety that the industry has reached. So that's a remarkable achievement on a global basis. But we need to do more. We need some Asian governments to strengthen their regulatory oversight. This is the only time in the presentation that we hear be asking for stronger regulatory oversight. But believe me, on safety, we need strong regulators. If we don't have strong regulators, airlines suffer, because even good airlines face sanctions from the likes of the EU or the US through no fault of their own. So we do need strong regulatory oversight, particularly in countries which are just emerging in Asia and where aviation is one of the first sectors to take off. And we need regulatory oversight to keep pace with that growth. On security, security's fine, but the process is anything but satisfactory. I haven't met anybody who enjoys security procedures or thinks that they're sensible. So one of the big debates in the industry is how do we move towards a more intelligence-led and outcome-based security measures, rather than saying, here's what you must do, the ritual of the security screening. And slowly, risk-based thinking, trying to identify higher risks and stop treating every passenger as a suspect, the 100% mistrusted traveler program, to get away from that. 8 million people a day, how many suspects today? 2 opinions, one is 8 million, and the other is, you reckon? None. They're just people traveling. So somewhere we've got to get the balance right in terms of what's the right philosophy. The problem with screening, when there aren't any bad guys that day, is you're just wasting everyone's time. It's what's called security theater. So there is an interesting philosophical discussion going on. Then there are more practical issues. If you think today's security is bad, try doubling the volumes over the next 15 years. So we're supporting the IATA checkpoint in the future studies, saying this isn't going to scale, this isn't sustainable, how do we move things forward? Even in the States, it's interesting to see how John Pistol at TSA has introduced the pre-check program. It started off as pilots going through less intrusive screening. It's now being expanded to 25% of the traveling public, with ambitions to get it to 50% of the traveling public. This will bring American TSA screening more into line with what's normal in the rest of the world, and it's a big step forward for the US, even though they've come at it from a roundabout route. Air cargo security is equally important. This air cargo supply chain doesn't start at the airport, it starts at the factory where the goods are made and packed. And so air cargo security depends on a much wider web of trusted relationships. Shippers, manufacturers, trucking companies, the overall security of the system, and when it gets to your final destination, through the warehousing, etc. It's the entire supply chain that needs to be protected, not just aviation, point to point from airport to airport. So it's rather different from passenger security. It needs a different approach. The Americans have their own way of doing it, which they're trying to persuade the rest of us to use. The Europeans have introduced a new scheme of audits. Again, from an Asian point of view, we're carrying 40% of the cargo, but who's making the rules? It's the usual story. Lastly, cybersecurity is an emerging threat. This is not specific to our industry, but everything depends on computer IT network systems today. Airlines have known this for years, but modern life is completely electronically integrated information systems. So thinking about exposure to cybersecurity threats and attacks is an up-and-coming topic, certainly at the Aviation Security Conference, which took place in Istanbul recently. On environment, I've already talked about it. You're either an expert on this and love it, or you think, why are they going on and on about it? Aviation does a good job on fuel efficiency, technology, operations, and infrastructure. We've set ambitious environmental goals. Delivering carbon neutral growth 2020, capping emissions from 2020 for our industry, cannot be achieved without market-based measures, which is why industry is enthusiastic about them, even though they will cost the industry money, the passengers money. We can't implement a carbon neutral growth market-based measure. Only governments can mandate market-based measures. So it's over to the governments. This year, as John Schlosser said, has been fascinating because we've spent years as industry trying to find the way forward. This year we've made some big progress. One, we got a strong industry consensus, and not just airlines at the IATA AGM. The Air Transport Action Group brings together manufacturers, engine manufacturers, airlines, airports. Everybody was on the same page supporting the industry position. And without that clear commitment from industry, the governments at Montreal wouldn't have got to where they got to. If you've never been to an ICAO assembly, I'll give you a flavor. 1,191 governments, 1,400 people, single government delegations of 40, 50 people, but 170 government representatives, governments represented in the room. Everything imaginable from the smallest island state to the major powers. But one country, one vote. It's an interesting process. Europe can muster about 44 votes. Africa can muster more if they work together. So what we saw was a political dynamic, and for the first time, Europe, even with the nod from the US, discovered it cannot impose its, and getting the Africans on board, it could not impose its will on the rest of the world. And there were some very big set pieces with big votes, which are very unusual in ICAO, since a roll call vote takes about 45 minutes. And we had three in one day. And Europe essentially was knocked back, very firmly rejected in terms of what Europe was proposing as an airspace solution before 2020 in Europe. But the good news was, by the end of the day, well, it's a two-week meeting, but by the end of the critical day, the big developing states had said, we're up for this, provided you developed states accept certain principles. And the consensus that we got at the end, all the players were there. It was a pretty tentative consensus, but everybody was there. China, India, Brazil, Russia, many of the big developing states working together very effectively to say, we're not going to accept this, here's what might be acceptable. So the end result was something that's remarkable because it represented the first time we had a global consensus on the need to develop a global NBM and the fact that it has to be fair and equitable, and you have to reconcile these differing interests of big rich states and faster growing developing states. We're not there yet, but there is the foundation. Now, it's a disappointment, as I said in my remarks this morning, that within a few weeks of that meeting, Europe announced they were going to dust off some proposals to expand the EU ETS. Remember, a year ago, we had Matthew Baldwin here hinting that they were going to stop the clock, and they did that week. And since then, they've stopped the clock on international aviation being in the EU ETS. The new proposal says we're going to restart the clock, but it's a new scheme. It's going to be European airspace only, and there are going to be exemptions for certain states, but you need to read 120 pages to find out what it is. And they're proposing to do this. Now, frankly, this airspace approach is exactly what they put forward at Montreal, and where they lost a decisive vote by a very heavy vote against. exactly that concept. So why they would pick up and say, well, we heard that, but we're going to go ahead anyway. I don't understand. As I said earlier, let's hope that there's a rethink. Let's hope that this doesn't distract us from the need to work towards what the world really needs, which is a global NBM. On passenger facilitation, you may not know it, but several days before you fly, the government who is receiving you receives all your personal details. But when you arrive, you're a stranger. You have to stand in line for sometimes an hour, 2 hours, and then have an interview before they let you into the country. We're not exploiting the fact we have the technology, the information, to streamline the process. At the other extreme, I used to live here having a Hong Kong ID card. I come back to Hong Kong, it takes me 15 seconds to go through the gate to get back into Hong Kong. Same in Singapore or other places. So on the one hand, we've got the benefits of automation, and on the other, we sit down with our friends in Washington and say, we had another day the other day at Los Angeles where it took 2 hours for our passengers to arrive in the country. So passenger facilitation, streamlining the flow, we're working with airports, but the key is government processing. And we need to find ways to make that work more smoothly. On passenger rights, some governments are introducing a lot of rules on passenger rights. The US have dozens of rules. Europe has comprehensive legislation. Many other countries, including some in this part of the world, are introducing similar rules. But there are some outliers. Australia and Singapore said, no, we've looked at it. We've decided we have general consumer protection. We don't need to introduce special rules for aviation. Passengers, consumers are quite capable of choosing between no frills, bare bones fares, or this with various protections and assurances of what will happen if disruptions occur. So our view is that consumer choice is what delivers value in a competitive marketplace. We're worried that the industry is moving back towards micromanagement regulation. I'll close by just saying a few things about future growth. I'll use one slide from Boeing and one from Airbus. This is a Boeing chart. I use this to highlight the fact that in 1992, North America and Europe was 73% of the global aviation. In 2012, it's 52%. In 2032, it'll be down to 39%, but the market grows hugely. And Asia's share, I said right now, we're about 30 on passenger, and it keeps on growing. By 2032, Asian aviation will be about 34% of a much, much bigger market. What's driving that is the growing middle class. Now, you can discuss what a middle class means, but this uses a definition between $10 and $100 a day of disposable income. The key point from this chart is the big growth in the middle class is taking place in our region. Very dramatic growth. You lift people out of poverty, but there's another threshold in which people have enough money to spend on travel, and as they reach that threshold, it creates huge growth in demand for travel. We've seen it already. This just projects that it will continue. By this analysis, you know, 60% of the world's population is going to be in middle class. So this is good news. It's good news from a consumption point of view, general well-being of humanity. But it does underpin the enthusiasm about the growth prospects for Asia. I won't dwell on this. The blue bar on the right is where we are today. The gray bar are the projections. It's just the figure I just mentioned, that we go to 34% of a market that's 2.5 times bigger. Basically, the global market grows by 2.5 times. Roughly speaking, Asia will grow by 3 times, which is where Chris Buckley from Airbus was saying 11,000 new aircraft. Basically, the fleet's going to triple. So some replacements, some additions, but that's the scale of the expansion. Brings its own problems. Infrastructure, airports, air navigation has to keep up. I said yesterday to the media, you know, if you don't get this right, you hit a brick wall. If you don't have any more runways, you don't have any more slots, you don't have enough airspace, once you hit congestion and service levels deteriorate, you're in big trouble. It's very hard to extricate yourself from those tight spots once you hit the congestion point. So we need governments to think ahead. We need coordination. We need investment in necessary air traffic management expansion and the deployment of the best available tools and technologies to make sure that we maintain safety and we can handle the future growth in traffic volumes. So just to wrap up, Asian Airlines, I've said it before, but it's still true, are at the forefront of industry innovation. There's a shared confidence and optimism about the future. The present may be pretty tough, but the future looks great. It's a complex and challenging business environment. A global industry needs harmonized regulations. 191 national regulations, to get that to be harmonized global regulation needs a lot of effort. And that's where Asian Pacific needs a unified voice, and I really appreciate, John, your comments this morning emphasizing how that game needs to be played. Believe me, other regions of the world have been playing this game a lot longer than we have in terms of influencing, steering, and shaping the regulatory agenda by speaking with a single voice when it's needed. So as an industry, we're committed to sustainable growth. We don't take it for granted. The environmental agenda is important for that reason. You cannot stand here and say, we're going to double and triple the size of this industry without having a strong sustainability platform, which is why we come back to why so much time and attention has been focused on the environmental agenda. Because without that, you do not have what's called in environmental terms the license to grow. You can't presume to grow unless it's legitimized as being sustainable growth. With that, thank you, and keep those pictures coming. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Herdman. Please join us. So we will now open to the floor for a Q&A section. So any questions, please feel free to raise your hand and we will have a microphone for you. So any questions, ladies and gentlemen? Oh, okay, yes, the gentleman in the back.
Mark Elliott from Travel Daily. John said this morning about the AAPA, how it could step up and be the voice of negotiation and reason for Asian Airlines. What's your response to that?
I very much welcome it. I mean, we've said it, but it's much better coming from someone of John's stature and standing. John also emphasized it's the teamwork. You need leadership, you need a team. The team is built around the commitment. And the work of the AAPA, like most trade associations, we run a very lean operation. And the power of the trade association comes from the commitment of the members, adding their support, but also behind the scenes generating the positions that they do support. Because this stuff needs a lot of work. Deciding, okay, even if we agree we're going to have a single voice, what's our position going to be? And that work needs a lot of input from the subject matter experts of the carriers. We very much value that.
All right, thank you. So, any more questions? All right, in this case, please give one more big hand to Mr. Herdman.